ASMR, we will be discussing the periodic table. As always, I am Professor Sherlock, and today's class is going to be online because I really didn't want to go to work today. Now, some things to note before we begin is that this is largely going to be just practical stuff. This is not a history lesson, this is a chemistry lesson. So I hope you're prepared for that, because everything I'm about to say will be on the final exam. Alright, so the first thing to note is that the periodic table as we know today was designed by a Russian dude named Mendeleev. What is molar mass? I can hear you say. Well, I'll tell you, students. Molar mass is the mass in a... Okay. So, if you were to take the molar mass is the amount of grams that is one... that how many grams are in one mole of that element or molecule? Basically means that when you have one mole, you have 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd atoms in a mole, which is useful because now you can figure out how many atoms are in a thing if you know the mass of the thing and the chemical composition of the thing. Either way, molar masses are easy to calculate for molecules, you just add them together. Most of chemistry is organic or thereabouts. All the atoms in your body are basically right here. Like 90% of the atoms, like 99% of the atoms in your body, right here. The rest of it is just filler. I mean, there's some iron. I should admit, there is iron. But other than that, oh, and of course hydrogen. This stuff. And hydrogen. This other crap, it's all important. Well, most of it is. vibe. They're vibing, okay? And it's very important to note that halogens, this row, so the pink row here, if you can see that, halogens and alkali metals, they get along splendidly, as demonstrated. It's that person. interferes with how well this electron kind of just like vibes with the nucleus. That's basically Norm's notes on effective nuclear charge. Anyways, thorium. Thorium is fun. Why is thorium fun? Because when you activate thorium in a nuclear reactor, basically, so thorium actually is able to activate plutonium in a nuclear reactor in such a way, because like typically nuclear reactors, when they're on, they're always producing power, which is a problem because if it ever goes into like meltdown, you want to be able to shut off power creation. Nuclear reactors don't do that. They just keep producing and they keep producing. And it's like, Chernobyl. By the way, nuclear power, good. Don't. Like, it's actually cleaner than coal stations. Okay, let me make that clear. Every problem with nuclear power has arisen from human error. The same. Anyways, so, thorium, when in the presence of plutonium, activates the plutonium, like a certain plutonium isotope, activates the plutonium. And then, when you shield the thorium, the plutonium starts creating power. So it's like, you lift up a little thing, and the plutonium, the thorium shoots, like, stuff at the plutonium, and it, like, it's like, plutonium's like, woo, let's make some energy. And it's like, oh, we're making too much energy, we're going into overreacting. Just close the door on the thorium, and it's like, oh, no more energy. And life is good. Tungsten's pretty neat. Has the highest melting point out of any other, thing. Element. So it stays solid for longer. Honestly, some of these names are really dumb. Like, you got europium, dysprosium, holmium, californium. I mean, seriously, californium. Really? Who names an element after a state as opposed to a person? Like, if you had the opportunity to name an element and have it forever immortalized, would you seriously name it after the state it was discovered in? I mean, it's just ridiculous. And then, like, some are just incredibly long. And then some are nice, like, ununceptium, which is just like seven. And it's the 117th element. So it's like, oh, makes sense. There's a bit of a song, you can find songs on a thing, there's various ones. There's antimony, arsenic, aluminum, selenium, and hydrogen, and oxygen, and nitrogen, and uranium, and nickel, uranium, and iron, and magnesium, and cesium, vanadium. That's one. I like the one that goes in order. There's hydrogen, and helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, everywhere, nitrogen all through the air. There's oxygen, so you can breathe in fluorine for your pretty teeth, neon to light up the signs. here's a bit. Glass isn't actually a solid, it's a slow-moving liquid. So if you have a plane of glass and you just like, you know, like a window, and you just let it sit for like a long time, the glass, and then you measure it, like after a certain amount of time, the glass will be thicker on the bottom and thinner at the top, and that's because the glass is slowing down. It's not a perfect crystalline structure. I like vanadium. I just like the word vanadium. Vanadium, 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 vanadium. I think it's a fun word. Neptunium's pretty nice. Let's see. Oh, my favorite element is thulium. I'm gonna let you guess why. It's thulium. 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 If you can figure out why, you're officially a mega genius. Oh, wink. Let's see. Yeah, there's kind of like a lot of stuff to talk about. I'm like, I don't know what to talk about first. Like, this is literally my degree, so I can talk about this forever. So she was just like, and her notebook that she wrote all her notes on the element down is so radioactive you can't actually handle it, like physically. You have to do it through like protective stuff. So you want to talk about sacrifices for science, Madame Curie. and some freaking bacteria got the idea to photosynthesize, started kicking out all this oxygen, and next thing you know, we've got an extinction event going on that wipes out like 99% of the planet. Luckily this was early, so it's not like there were people running around, but it's still like... Oxygen is slowly killing you. You're basically combusting slowly. Alright, class, I think, man, I've been talking for about, like, half an hour, at least, it feels like. And like I said, I really didn't want to go to work today, so, I mean, I guess, you know, you can just kind of doodle in your notebooks for the remaining little bit. Because, I mean, what else is there to say? You got your atomic number, which basically, it's the number of protons, but it's like, what do you freaking do? Protons are honestly very boring. There's nothing going on. Same with neutrons. Neutrons are just stuff. It's just there to get in the way. The atomic wave, which is pretty neat. These elements down here, they only last for a fraction of a fraction of a fraction of a second. And they can only be created in the Large Hadron Collider. And so, you know, it's a bit of a pet peeve of mine when, like, in like, sci-fi movies, they're always like, "Oh, you've created a new element." And it's like, where could you have created a stable new element? Because let me tell you, shoop gets pretty unstable, like, the further down you go, and we've got this locked down. We know this. This has all been proven time and time again. This stuff, like, seriously, fractions of fractions of fractions of a second. And it drives me nuts. Honestly, I'm looking at you, Iron Man 2. "Congratulations, sir. You have created a new element." Yeah, well, guess what, dog? Where have you created? Are you saying you've discovered the 119th element? That's cool and all, but that crap would decompose in no time at all. Like, you'd create it and it would go. I know I'm getting worked up over a work of fiction, but still. Kill you to have some scientific minds involved. Yeah. I need a hobby. Okay, so you know how I said that every column corresponds to, like, how many bonds it can make? And then you know how I said it was full of exceptions? That's what I mean. So nitrogen technically make three bonds, but it is very common for it to make four just because of that lone pair that we're like, "Hey, we need you to, like, give some electrons to this thing so you can bond. You're gonna be an ion, so you're gonna be charged, but we don't care." And nitrogen, we're like, "Oh, okay." And oxygen can technically only make two, but sometimes it makes three, albeit temporarily. It's not like it's always three. It's very rarely that it has three bonds for longer than, like, a second. But, except carbon, like I said, is the only one that is not the exception. Everything down this way makes more than one bond occasionally, and this stuff makes, like, nine bonds sometimes. So it's like, it's very easy to look at this and get overwhelmed. Much like Mendeleev's beard. You look at it, you get overwhelmed. Seriously, barbers were a thing in Russia, weren't they? That beard was a mess. Any questions? I'm willing to take any questions from the class. You might notice I'm wearing a lab coat, and I have the sleeve bunched up. I know this is not proper lab safety, but then again, my lab coat is undone, I don't have safety glasses on, and I'm not in the lab, so it's fine. You're allowed to look like, you know, one of those cool science guys from whatever show. Sleeve bunched up and your coat undone if you're not in a lab. Every other time, no. really a science. I just made so many physicists